A very good morning to all of you. We shall discuss this poem today, Childhood by Marcus Natten. It's on page number 58. I hope I'm audible to all of you, online students. Okay, fine. Okay, good. So this poem has been written by Marcus Natten, and this poem deals with the curiosity of the poet. And who is the poet? Marcus Natten. It deals with his curiosity to know. He wants to know when an individual stops to be a child. Okay, so there is no clear-cut demarcation as it is, you know, between your infancy and your childhood, your teenage, your adulthood. There is no clear-cut demarcation, and he actually is trying to just figure out, and he's wondering at what age, at what time, at what stage does an individual cease or stop to be a child. Okay, so this is what, and he tries to probe, he tries to get answers to these questions in this particular poem. So I'm going to recite it, I'm going to read it out once, and then we'll do the explanation part. Okay, so he says, when did my childhood go? Was it the day I ceased to be 11? Was it the time I realized that hell and heaven could not be found in geography and therefore could not be? Was that the day? When did my childhood go? Was it the time I realized that adults were not all they seemed to be? They talked of love and preached of love, but did not act so lovingly. Was that the day? When did my childhood go? Was it when I found my mind was really mine, to use whichever way I choose, producing thoughts that were not those of other people, but my own and mine alone? Was that the day? Where did my childhood go? It went to some forgotten place that's hidden in an infant's face. That's all I know. So the very first thing that the poet does is he puts up a question to the readers, to the audience. And the question is, when did my childhood go? Okay, so he talks about the time. He's asking about the time when he ceased to be a child. So he's asking, was it the day I ceased to be 11? What does it mean? I ceased means I stopped being 11. That means I turned 12. So does it mean that a child stops being a child after the age of 11? Okay, is that the time? This is what he means in this. So there are various possibilities that he talks about in this poem particularly, which are responsible for the end of the childhood period. Okay, so he says, was it the time I realized that hell and heaven could not be found in geography? What does it mean? As a child, we have been told time and again about stories of hell and heaven, you know, to talk about, you know, trying to justify things and trying to figure out what is right, what is wrong. Like people, the you know, our elders, the adults, they keep on telling us, ki achhe kaam karo, nahi to aap nark mein jaoge. Okay, so the as a child, if a child listens to all these stories about hell and heaven, he tries to figure it out that these are the places that are found in geography books. Like we have other places, so there might be hell and heaven would also be places in geography books. So he feels and he says, was please children, it's a request to all of you, join in time. You keep on disturbing me throughout the class. There are students who keep on joining the class even 10 minutes before the class is going to end. What does he mean by this? That was it the time I realized that hell and heaven could not be found in geography and therefore could not be. So what does he mean by this? So he started searching for, after hearing the stories about hell and heaven, he started searching for these places, and he found out that these are only imaginary places because he could not locate them, he could not find them in any of the geography books. So he comes to this he comes to this logical conclusion that if they are not found in any of the geography books, they are not there. Okay, so therefore that is why he says, and therefore could not be. Was that the day? Okay, have you followed this first stanza? Have you all followed this first stanza? Speak up, online students. So it's pretty simple, he says, because it is only in the geography books that you find places, you know, it is a study of different places only. And since there is no mention, he could not locate hell and heaven in any of the geography books, he comes to the conclusion, and very rationally, very logically, very practically, he concludes that hell and heaven do not exist anywhere. Okay, so if we look at the poetic devices that are there in this first stanza, can you tell me some of the poetic devices that are used in this stanza? the poetic devices that are used here. Anybody? There is one poetic device that we see prevailing throughout the poem, and that is refrain. Does anyone know what refrain is? R-E-F-R-A-I-N. What is this poetic device, refrain? Does anyone have this idea? What is refrain? So you can just write it down in your books or in your notebooks. Refrain is a group of words, or it's a phrase that is repeated throughout the poem. So can you tell me which is the word, which is the phrase that is being repeated throughout the poem? Raise your hand.
Like, when did my childhood go? And he giving the answer, like, what is given day?
Yes. So he keeps
when I ceased to be 11, was it the time I realized
yes.
that
well,
hell
right,
and heaven could not
you're
be
very right.
So it's only this. See, you just have to mention that phrase, and that phrase is, when did my childhood go? You need not explain it. It's just a refrain is this phrase, when did my childhood go? And again, repeatedly, he throughout the poem in some of the stanzas, he says, was that the day? So this is repetition. Repetition of the phrase, repetition of a group of words throughout the poem, this that is refrain. Okay? So when did my childhood go? This is one phrase, and which is repeated in, you know, first three stanzas, and then towards the end of these three stanzas, we have another phrase that is, was that the day? So this is refrain. This is a poetic device, which clearly means repetition of a particular phrase throughout the poem. Okay, so can you find out any example of alliteration here? Any example of alliteration in the first stanza? Do we have? Yes, it is there in hell and heaven. It is there in hell and heaven. Okay, so it's H, repetition of the consonant sound H. Am I audible to you people? So hell and heaven is an example of alliteration. Then we have the refrain that we have done. But let's move on to the next stanza. Again, he says, when did my childhood go? Was it the time that I realized that adults were not all they seemed to be? They talked of love and they preached of love, but they did not act so lovingly. Was that the day? So what does he mean by this? He says that, what did he observe? What did he feel about the adults? Is that the adults are double-faced. They are hypocritical people. And what does he mean? He says they sermonize, they preach one thing, but there's a lot of difference between what they actually do, what they practice, and what they preach. Okay, so he wants to say that, was that the time that I realized that adults were not all they seem to be? He means to say that they are double-faced people. Adults are double-faced people, and there is a large gap between their sayings and their action. You know, the kind of practice that they do and the kind of words that they preach. Okay, so there is a large gap between the two. They talked of love and they preached of love. So, you know, they keep on talking of love, that we should have universal brotherhood, but they themselves indulge in a lot of violence. Okay, they fight with each other, but they preach of love. They feel that, keep on telling the children that you should, you know, remain, there should be unity, there should be universal brotherhood, you should act lovingly to others, but they themselves do not practice any such kind of thing. So was that the time? So he's kind of becoming mature, you know, and he says that he's not accepting the things by their face value, and he tries to question out things. Like, if the adults are professing love, you know, but why don't they practice that? So this is what he means to say by this. Okay, so he says that now the adults are totally hypocritical people, and they have lost all their innocence, and they've turned hypocrites. Okay, this is what he means by this particular line. And there is a poetic device that is used here. There is a literary device that is used here. That is, this is irony. You can write it down. Irony is being used here, and the line which is ironical is, they talked of love and they preached of love, but they did not act so lovingly. So this is irony. know, you talk about one thing, but you do totally opposite. Okay? So this is what he means to say by this line, that the adults were not all they seemed to be. They professed of love, they talked of love. The grown-up people, you know, they have attached certain values, certain qualities. There are certain qualities which are attached to the grown-up people, to the adults. But he wants to say that they behave and they totally talk. They talk in a certain manner, but they behave in totally opposite manner. Okay. So they didn't talk, they didn't behave in a manner as was expected from them. Okay. So they show a lot of hatred towards each other. They fight. They don't keep their calm. They engage in violence. But they don't practice what they preach in their life. This is basically what he means to say. Okay. Followed. And we've talked about irony here, that he uses this literary device, irony, when he says they talked of love and they preached of love, but they did not act so lovingly. Followed. Next is, when did my, again, the same refrain, the same repetition is there. This is the central theme of this poem also. When did my childhood go? He keeps on pondering, he keeps on wondering about the stage, the age, the time when he lost his childhood. So he says, when did my childhood go? Was it when I found my mind was really mine? Okay. And to use whichever way I choose, producing thoughts that were not those of other people, but my own and mine alone. Was that the day? So what does he mean by this when he says, I found my mind was really mine? It means that he has, you know, found his identity. He has discovered his individuality. He finds that he is also a unique being. He is different from the others. He is unique. He's one of his own kind. And he starts trusting his own ability to think, to reason, to not just blindly follow what the others tell him to do, okay, or how to behave. So this is the time when he says, was it the time when I found my mind was really mine? To use whichever way I choose, to use whichever way I choose means, now he has started becoming kind of assertive. What is assertion? What is this term? Being assertive. What is being assertive? Yes, online students. When he said to use whichever way I choose, and if I say that the child has started becoming a little bit defiant and he has started showing his assertion, he's started becoming assertive. What does he mean by this? Yes, he started becoming confident of his own abilities, that he can think on his own, he can behave the way he wants to behave. He doesn't have to depend on others to tell him how he should behave, what he should do. Okay, he has his own logical abilities, he has his own reasoning abilities. Okay, so he says that producing thoughts that were not those of others, but my own and mine alone. So what does he mean by this? That producing, that he can think whatever he wants to think. He doesn't have to borrow his thoughts from the others. He has his own mental abilities working. He can think on his own. So here in this particular stanza, what is the poet talking about? He's talking about his own individuality. Okay. And he says, was that the day when I realized that I can think on my own, I can decide on my own? Was that the day that I ceased to be a child, that I stopped being a child? Okay. Got it? So the last stanza says, where did my childhood go? It went to some forgotten place that's hidden in an infant's face. That's all I know. So he's deeply regretting the loss of his childhood. Now he has changed his question. Initially, he was talking about the time, the stage, when he lost his, in the first three stanzas, he's talking about the time, the stage, when he lost his childhood. But now in the last stanza, what is he talking about? He's trying to find the place where he had lost his childhood. Okay. So he says, where did my childhood go? It went to some forgotten place that's hidden in an infant's face. That's all I know. So he says childhood is a kind of a lost memory. You can recall all the fantasies that you had as a child. You can recall all the moments that were associated with your childhood, but that innocence, once it is lost, it is irrevocably lost. What do you mean by irrevocably lost? What is irrevocable? You've discussed this word earlier also. What is irrevocable? Which cannot be come back, which cannot be retrieved, which cannot come back. Okay, so something which is lost forever. So you can relive, although he wants to say that innocence is a kind of a cyclical process. In this stanza, what is he stressing on? He's stressing on the fact that innocence is a cyclical process. And how is it a cyclical process? He says that it is lost from one person, then it travels to another person, and it finds a residence there. It rests there. Okay, and adults can easily, you know, recall, and they can relive. They seem to almost relive all their innocence, all the childhood through the face of an infant. When you look at a small child, you recall your own memories as a child. Okay, and you relive those past moments through that infant's face. Okay, so that is why he says that's hidden in an infant's face. My childhood is hidden. I can relive those moments, but they are lost for me. They are irrevocable. I will never be able to get them back, but I can still, you know, relive those moments by looking at the face of an infant, a small child. Got it? Have you followed? That is all I know. So he says that he deeply regrets that loss of his childhood, and he says that I will never be able to get it back. So the kind of you know, literary device that has been used here is paradox. You can write it when contrasting ideas are put together. And which are the contrasting ideas? Which is the idea that is paradoxical in the last stanza? Anyone from among the online students? Which is the idea that is paradoxical? Bolo.
Only two offline students are here today. Anybody? Which is the idea which is contrasting, which is paradoxical? Down. Okay, paradoxical idea is the idea that childhood is lost, the idea that childhood is lost, yet it eternally remains in some form or the other, is paradoxical. The idea that childhood is lost, but it remains eternally in some form or the other, this entire idea is paradoxical. Okay, so there is a sense of nostalgia. There is a sense of nostalgia that the poet feels for his lost childhood. Okay, there is a sense of nostalgia. He's feeling nostalgia. Okay, have you all followed, online students? Is this poem clear to you? Please put it over. Okay, so let me put up certain questions from you people. And there is another poetic device that is allusion. In the first stanza, you can just write it down there. There is another poetic device that is allusion. And allusion is an indirect or a passing reference. What is allusion? A-double-L-U-S-I-O-N. Allusion is an indirect or a passing reference. And where do we find allusion? In the concept of hell and heaven. The concept of hell and heaven, which are given to us in our childhood as part of moral instruction to develop a sense of right or wrong, that we discussed earlier also. Like, people keep on telling us that if we follow the right path, if we always do the right things, then we'll go to heaven. Otherwise, we'll all land in hell. So this is just a passing reference. This is an allusion. Got it? Okay. So let me ask a few questions. We'll discuss the textbook questions. Okay, let's discuss the textbook questions also. Identify the stanzas that talks about each of the following. Individuality. Bataya tha maine aapko. Which is the stanza that talks about individuality? Type it in the chat box, online students. It is the third stanza. Yes. And rationalism. Rationalism. Stanza one. Yes. And hypocrisy. Stanza 2. Okay. What, according to the poem, is involved in the process of growing up? What is involved in the process of growing up? Childhood is, no, that is okay, infancy, childhood. You're talking about the three different stages. You're not talking about the stages. We are, Akashita says, losing child within you and developing. rationalistic outlook, developing that logical bent of mind, and that ability when you can see through the double-faced adults. Yes, loss of childhood is involved, and you can see through the hypocrisy of the adult. So what all goes on, and when you discover your own individuality, that means you just have to sum up the three, what is there in the three stanzas. Getting a rationalistic outlook, a practical bent of mind, ability to see through the hypocrisy of the adults, and also the knowledge of your own discovery of your own individuality. These are the things which are involved in the process of growing up. Got it? What is the poet's feeling towards childhood? What does he feel towards childhood? Raise your hands, online students. What does the poet feel towards childhood? What are his feelings towards childhood? Akarshita has already given one of the answers. Somebody else? There are 34, 35 students apart from Akarshita. Who can give me the answer to this question? What are the poet's feelings towards child? What does he feel towards? It is a period of innocence and simplicity, yes. What else? The poet remembers his childhood, he likes it, and he laments that it is gone. Yes, he's regretting that his childhood is gone, but he knows it very well that once it is lost, it cannot be retrieved. We cannot get it back once it is lost. And we can only see it, we can have a reflection of it hidden in the face of an infant. Okay? Yes, it get a free from all the earthly evils. Yes. So it is an irrevocable process. Yes, very good. And which according to you are the most poetic lines? The answers may vary, and you need to tell why. Which are the most poetic lines according to you, and you need to give the reason also why do you find them the most poetic. And this answer may vary. This is an individual choice. You can do it on your own. Okay. Now let me ask a few questions from you people. From the different stanzas. Okay. Just look at the first stanza. Concentrate on the first stanza and tell me, how does a scientific approach of the child transform his thinking? How does a scientific approach transform a child's thinking? Yes. How does a scientific approach of the child transform his thinking? Anyone? Apart from Akarshita. Akarshita is always the first one to raise her hand. What about the others? Where do we find the scientific bent of mind, the scientific approach, and how does it transform the child's thinking? Okay, Akarshita, you can give the answer. Just hold on for a moment and then you can give.
Being told about things which are imaginary and which feel very fancy, and it's completely based upon the imaginary and the thought of an individual as a child. But as we grow, we realize that those thoughts which we've been thinking is completely wrong. And that rational thought and scientific approach completely kills the imagination within an individual, because it arises in my mind and everybody's mind is that childhood is far away from fact. But when fact hits us, that childhood, that innocence is lost.
Yes. Okay, very good. So it is, when he starts developing his rational outlook, he starts developing the scientific approach, he comes out of that, the world of fantasizing, that make-believe world, the world of imagination. Okay, so and he starts, it is at that particular point of time that he starts leaving his innocence, he starts leaving his childhood. Okay. What makes the child doubt the existence of hell and heaven? Why does he doubt the existence of hell and heaven? Very simple question. What makes him doubt the existence of hell and heaven? Very simple. Yes, Tanisha is right. There is no mention of hell and heaven in geography books. And since we have been taught, we know it, that it is only the geography books that we study about different places. But since there is no mention of, there is no location of hell or heaven in any of the geography textbooks, so he very practically, the child concludes that these places do not exist anywhere. Okay. Next stanza is in one. when did my childhood go? And was it the time I realized that adults were not all they seemed to be? What did the child observe about the adults? What is his observation about the adults? People, students, you can even type in the chat box. If you don't want to speak up, you can type. What did the child observe about the adults? Yes, Tushita. Tushita, you can give the answer, but hold on. Hold on.
Not all that they seem to be. They talked of love and gave advice of love, but did not act so affectionately.
Yes, very good. So he feels that the adults are
hypocritical people. They are double-faced. They talked of love, they preached of love, and they give lessons about love, but they themselves never follow, they never practice those lessons. So they are hypocrites. Okay. Yes, they spoke something else and they did something else. You are very right. Yes. Next is, what idea do you get about the child who learns to see through the hypocrisy of the adult? What do you feel about the child then? That the child has become what? He's grown up and he's become mature. Yes, he's become mature now that he can see through the hypocrisy of the adults. Okay. And next is, very good, Ishita. Yes, you all are right when you said mature. Third sensa, when did my childhood go? Was it the time when I found my mind was really mine? I found my mind was really mine. What does this phrase mean? I found my mind was really mine. Yes. Anybody apart from Tushita or Akashita? Explain this phrase. I found my mind was really mine. Yes, Rashan, can you give the answer? When he said, my mind was really mine. What does it mean? Yes, he has his own thoughts. He can think upon himself. And he has his own, he has discovered his own individuality. He has discovered that he is also a unique being who is different from the others, and he starts trusting his own self, his own ability to reason out and his own ability to think logically. Okay, to use whichever way I choose. How does this line indicate a change in the child's attitude and behavior? What has the child become? What change in his attitude has come? When we did this sensa, he has become assertive. Yes, very good, Tanisha. Next, and also he's come to know that he has his own identity, his own individuality. Okay. And last tensa, where did my childhood go? It went to some forgotten place. What does he feel about, what does the speaker feel about the loss of his childhood? What does he feel about the loss of his childhood?
Ma'am, so over here in the last tensa, the poet feels very sad because his question from when completely changes to when, and he doesn't want to go any further in the process of finding that when did it vanish to where did it go, and now he is searching that where was the place when he lost this most important precious thing which was most innocent and pure to him.
Yes. So he, what does he feel in simple words? You can see
he's feeling very regretful and he's feeling very nostalgic about the loss of his child.
He's regretting that he has lost his childhood and the thing that he has lost is never going to come back to him again. This is something which is irrevocable. It will never be, it can never be retrieved. Okay, good. Follow. Then he says, is the poet still a child or a grown up? Which line gives you a clue to this answer? Is he still a child or a grown-up? The last stanza. The very first line when he says, where did my childhood go? This is the best clue to the answer. That means he's no longer a child. That is why he's saying, where did it go? Okay? This means that he has already lost his child. Okay? And what do you mean by this phrase? That's hidden in an infant's face. What do you mean by this? That's hidden in an infant's face.
That when he sees an infant's face, he recalls that his own childhood.
Yes, very good. When he looks at the face of an infant, he recalls the memories of his own childhood and he tries to relive all those things, all those incidents, all those memories through that infant. Okay. So this is all about this poem. You can go through it. I'll put an assignment in the Google Classroom, and you have to do it, and you have to submit it to me in time by Thursday. Okay. So let's move on to your attendance part. If there's anything that you have to ask, you can ask me here.